I've made a video like this one before. The central concept was expanding Minecraft's sandbox through dynamic systems. Additional sandbox elements would introduce new paths of creative expression for those who play for the sandbox, the intrinsically motivated. By mechanically incentivizing the use of those paths, we would add vastly more depth for those who play for the game, the extrinsically motivated. If you want an example, take the one that's already in Minecraft, Redstone. It's highly dynamic, allowing for creative expression, and in multiplayer, it has plenty of practical uses. Mumbo Jumbo is a testament to that. It's the perfect proof of concept, which is convenient, because the Redstone philosophy has one hell of a ring to it, don't you think? People liked it, but not everyone agreed. Some thought that my suggestions compromised Minecraft's simplicity, but now I would counter, Redstone is already in the game, and it's far more complex than the dynamic villages I suggested. Are people just too scared of change? Perhaps not. That got me thinking. Minecraft's sandbox appeal is the building. On a small scale, that's very simple. Pick up block, place block, every block is the same size. Easy, huh? What's so simple about that? Though the mechanic itself is simple, when compounded on thousands of times over, it becomes extremely complex, like the brushstrokes of a painter's landscape. So is Minecraft simple? On a larger scale, it has the capacity to be mind-bendingly complex. I didn't think that was any different than my dynamic villages or extensive horse breeding, but it is in one key area. You see, humans have an innate understanding of 3D space and how to manipulate it.
Oh, for God's sake.
Oh. Right, yeah, I see. I'm being kidnapped again. These guys... yeah, funny. Look, I've got the message loud and clear, okay?
I want to play a game.
No. No, it can't be. I know I played Starl at the start of my last video. I apologize, I'm sorry.
The question is, do you?
You know he's not gonna give up.
Hello, good sir. Would you like to hear about our Lord and Savior Raid Shadow Legends? No? No? Then why do you look like it? It's free to play. Raid is the sensation of the mobile world, the RPG that changes everything. 15 million downloads in the last 6 months! You do want to play Raid Shadow Legends, yeah you do. You want awesome 3D graphics
and 50k silver for signing up.
The game is growing super fast, and check out this cool roadmap that they've published. They're gonna add a new faction, a tag team arena feature, and even a new clan boss you'll be able to fight with your clanmates. Look at these graphics! Look at them! Not only are they awesome, but they're actually 3D! That's one more than 2D!
Weekly tournaments and events, fighting in the arena, running special dungeons, or just leveling up your heroes. There's always a way to compete and win extra prizes every week. You can find me in-game under the nickname Big Dick.
Go to the video description, click on special links, and you will get 50,000 silver and a free epic champion as part of the new player program to start your journey.
You want to listen, you want to dream, you want to smile, you want to hurt, you don't want to be.
Download Raid Shadow Legends, or watch your back. Because in the infinite, empty world, no one can hear you scream.
Did you guys just... I thought something happened. Where was I?
We know something that looks good when we see it, but humans do not have an innate understanding of geopolitics or strategy. We weren't built for that. The true difference between Minecraft's core sandbox element, building, and those that abide by the Redstone philosophy is accessibility. Name a game more accessible than Minecraft. The very rules are things we're naturally familiar with, like building and day-night cycles. Otherwise, they're so simplistic, anyone could grasp it, like the ores or the movement. Humans do not naturally understand electricity. To all but a few of us, it's magic. Which I suppose is why Redstone aficionados are known as wizards. It's the depth, the sandbox potential that makes Redstone so attractive. But can we have depth and accessibility at the same time? It's one thing to present a dream like I already have. What we're going to do today is another. We're gonna improve Minecraft Vanilla in a reasoned, realistic manner that caters to every player. We're going deeper than bees, but as easy to understand as ores. The problem we face is that many problematic mechanics in Minecraft will never change. I'd love to see a return of survival gameplay, but beds will stay as they are forever. If you think about it, Minecraft seems to abide by the philosophy that to access every distinct challenge, the player must make a distinct choice, like going through a portal or making the 2-hour trip to find a mansion. At a guess, I'd say 95% of worlds are played through without ever facing a boss or raiding one of the big three dungeons. Remove beds and watch as that changes. No distinct choice is made for the sun to go down. By nature, survival gameplay goes against Minecraft's choice for challenge philosophy. So I don't think there'll ever be a return to that focus in the mode we have today. Which is all the proof we need that if we're looking to mechanically incentivize building, it can never be through defense. And we are looking to do that. I believe the lack of it is Minecraft's greatest flaw. So if not defense, then what? Logically, farming. Fruit trees, far more types of crop that all grant different effects. It's a very simple idea, it's been done with mods. And in the relaxing setting that is Minecraft, the relaxing activity that is farming couldn't fit any better. I recently watched a video by Like Stories of Old, which suggested a Minecraft world that reacted to the player. For example, rewarding ethical animal farming with higher quality food. In 1.14, all livestock involves is a small ring of fences. It looks ridiculous, and it's far from interesting for the player. But now you'd want a watering hole, lots of space, a feeding regimen. You could herd them with wolves, automate feed with redstone. It sends a good message, and it's far more involved than the mindless process we have now. On the topic, horse breeding is an idea I can't seem to let go. It invites building stables, it's a very accessible process, and it's highly rewarding. More creatures might be a bit far, so how about some new species found in certain biomes? A nether horse that would run extremely quick, and an ender horse that could periodically teleport. Bring them back to the overworld with a lead, breed the two together, and stick an enchanted elytra on the foal's back for a pegasus. We're not just here to recreate Farming Simulator though. We're gonna village update the village update. Villages shouldn't feel like fixed points in the world. People are people. They're gonna live with you if you can provide. Housing, for example. You can build it and then invite villagers to stay. With the right housing, you could attract villagers of a certain profession. All you need is a bed, some space, and a chest. Think Terraria, but more customizable. Unlike Terraria though, we could assign fields to farmers and guard posts to soldiers. You don't need to understand geopolitics to understand the concept of two basic jobs. And through that, you could automate specific functions in your own home, which not only makes it feel alive, but is a good motivation, in addition to trading, to build for more people than just yourself. The last idea up my sleeve is something that I hear even Notch wanted in the game. Crafting stations that require physical upgrades. For example, you could only smith armor if you had an anvil next to a workbench. But that's very superficial. Let's take it further. To smith diamond tools, for example, you require a fully equipped blacksmith station, including a filled cauldron, a lava or fire pit, and an anvil within vicinity of a crafting bench. Ideally, the loose guidelines, the lack of restriction, would encourage creativity instead of having everyone resort to a homogenized design for ultimate efficiency. If you were down in a cave, you could just use a lava pool, a hole with some water in it, and an anvil, for example. We don't have to rely on roadblocks either. There could be a chance for an increased smithing yield if you had an activation frame around a blast furnace. It'd be a functional industrial smelter. There's plenty more to add to crafting over the course of this video, but the framework is set. Now let's turn our eyes down to the mine. We need a cave update. An original suggestion, I know. It does seem that a deeper block limit is quite a technical challenge, so I guess we'll have to accept defeat on that. But the painfully restrained cave generation needs a revival. I want weird caves, huge caves, tiny caves that give you claustrophobia. There's a thousand ways of making caves better to look at. But the most important part is, of course, the resources. Mojang will not one-up diamonds. Their supremacy is a part of the game's identity, and that will never change. But here's the thing. There was a time that diamonds were an elusive goal. They were almost magical in their power and rarity, and that's why finding one felt so good. But that was a time when every human alive wasn't intimately familiar with the game's ins and outs. That magic is, at least for me, gone after I find my first three diamonds. From there, I'm only looking for more of the same thing. That's just not as engaging. I want something that reintroduces the magic to mining. Rarer diamonds, then? The problem with that arises when you look at it statistically. Even if you compensate in some way, you still need diamonds, and due to their rarity, many people will find themselves roadblocked by a lack of them. Then, in their boredom and frustration, simply quit. It's not a viable solution. I want a constant sense of hope when mining, even when I have a full set of diamond gear. So a new resource then, rarer than diamonds and attractively powerful. Difference is, we change the function. It's an amplifier. A special anvil made from iron and diamonds, when combined with this new resource, would allow you to upgrade your gear far beyond anything you could have done before. Similarly, perhaps you could take it down to the enchanting table. In place of lapis, we can now supercharge our enchantments. Sharpness 7, looting 4, infinity squared, which actually gives you arrows. Speaking of arrows, what if I told you that shields and mining are directly linked with one another? And what if I told you that mining being so integral to the experience of the game has prevented its combat system from evolving in significant ways? You'll see. Minecraft certainly isn't a game that needs good combat, but it would benefit from an upgrade all the same. Mojang seemed to agree, having made a huge attempt at reviving it only a few years ago. They decided on minor depths, such as shields and the need to pace one's attacks. Did that revolutionize combat? Barely, but it made important improvements, shields being the most interesting. If you want to improve Minecraft's combat, the best place to start is reliable ways of avoiding damage. Being able to mitigate the damage of an enemy's attack is a key part of every decent combat system out there, isn't it? Good enemy design only works when their attacks are a challenge, not guaranteed damage. Challenge equals decisions, decisions equals fun, which is why the ability to respond to an enemy's attack is exactly where Minecraft should look to tap for depth. In fact, imagine we're already there. Imagine you're skilled with a system. Imagine Minecraft is just Dark Souls and you're dodging, blocking, and punishing your enemy's downtime. Aside from being good, what's different about how you're playing now from Minecraft's current combat? You're not healing as much. And what else? You're not relying on tanking attacks. Ah, you see, the instant a player can become skilled enough to avoid damage, armor becomes less desirable. So as does mining. And with vastly less motivation to mine, you've just gut-punched the whole game. A similar effect happens with food. Though healing is important in Dark Souls, in Minecraft it's pretty much impossible to survive without it. Now you see how important Minecraft's combat system being bad is to Minecraft as a whole. Shields are a compromise. Timing when to block a skeleton's shot so that you get the optimum time to punish is fantastic depth. There's a trade-off every time you raise or lower your shield. In this case, shields are a reliable way of avoiding damage, and yeah, that reduces the importance of armor. But not by too much, because enemies often come in packs. When you're surrounded, you're switching targets, attempting to block each one at the right time. For every additional enemy, that gets tougher. If two arrows fire at the same time, it's impossible. And if there's a melee mob, you must always be moving away from it. It becomes inhumanly hard to block all incoming damage. And so armor is still important. How do we improve on this situation without ruining the game? It's simple. We ruin the game. And then we fix it. I think a good place to look for ideas is Terraria. Its accessible combat has no complexities. It rewards aim, screen awareness, and movement like most 2D games. And yet, it's a blast, because enemy attacks are a challenge. They're telegraphed and they don't track, so you can avoid some attacks before they're fired. Otherwise, they take long enough to impact that you're almost always capable of moving out of the way. Dodging and weaving with simple movement mechanics remains the game's reliable way of avoiding damage. It's extremely accessible and yet deep. Can we do the same in a first-person 3D game? Well, actually, yeah, that's exactly what Doom does. Slow-moving projectiles, you can avoid them with basic movement. Problem is, Doom's enemies are designed for that, and I don't think Notch had Doom in mind back in Alpha. I also doubt that overhauling every enemy type is on the menu. The more realistic approach is this. First, we're introducing two new ways of reliably avoiding damage. The parry is very self-explanatory. You hit the shield bash button, and if you get the timing right, you're rewarded. For a ranged attack, it's reversed and in the same way as ghasts, thrown right back at them. For melee, a successful parry stuns the enemy, allowing you to punish. Our bases aren't covered yet, because this still doesn't fix the shield's problems in a group fight. What do we do in any other game with group fights? We dodge. The dash, a la Dying Light, would probably be a controversial addition, but it accomplishes two things. Firstly, even when facing away from an attacker, you can avoid it. You simply need the skill of timing and situational awareness. The second is a big one. It pops the cork on Minecraft's enemy design. With a dodge, the evoker could be a basic enemy. Attacks beyond simple projectiles and aggressive hugging can exist without being annoying and restricted to the hardest dungeons. Imagine the opportunities for new mobs. Let's keep going. The second layer of depth I'd like to add is an expansion on positioning. Right now, you can position yourself to have a skeleton shoot another mob in the back. The dash adds to this, since you can now make last-minute adjustments, but we can do better. By charging a parry, you instead get a shield bash. That bounces the target back like it was knockback 4. Let's tactically give hoes a use too. In addition to their extended range, a hit with a hoe pulls the target towards you. So now we have a level of influence over the position of every enemy, in very obvious, very accessible ways. There's a million things to do with this, but the obvious would be using creeper explosions to your advantage. You shoot a fire arrow at a creeper, hoe it towards you, raise your shield, and bang! Big risk, big reward. That's what I call crowd control. Dying Light is more like Minecraft than you might think. First person, most enemies rush you, and the best way of dealing damage is melee. It showed me that if you want to encourage an aggressive playstyle when you're fighting the undead, there needs to be ways of controlling the horde rather than letting it control you. Hence the importance of positioning. The dash is one way of achieving this, another would be the springboard, the ability to use an enemy as a trampoline for a larger jump, allowing repositioning and a much faster pace of combat. I don't think Minecraft would have trouble with something similar. Make it a timing challenge so it doesn't render zombies useless, and treat it like any normal jump. You could parry your 360 no-scope with a crossbow in mid-air. There's a lot of potential for combining moves for a more efficient effect, and there's a lot of depth to be found there. For another example, if we have it such that whenever you bash or pull a mob, it'll damage any other mob it touches and cause aggro, then good positioning can have an effect in almost any group fight. The hoe in that way acts like Mirror's Edge's grapple. You could even imagine doing the same thing in mid-air. Additional mobs with more creative attacks thanks to the dodge provides hundreds of opportunities for positioning to improve combat. We've also given hoes an extra use, and if more enemies used shields, axes would have one too. With minor balances, I think we could finally have ourselves a combat system that is both deep and highly accessible. But of course, none of that changes the fact that we've ruined Minecraft. To unruin it, we're going to do two things. Firstly, we overhaul shields. In my opinion, the current shield is way too good for the cost. Let's just have it follow the same rules as any other tool. Material tiers with diamond being the strongest. Something else I've considered is additional inspiration from Dark Souls, whereby only the strongest shields actually block all of an attack's damage. So for example, a wooden shield would only block half of an attack's effect. Armor becomes more useful more often that way, further soothing the problem. A reliable way of reducing damage instead of avoiding it is still functional with balance, because we still have the dash. That'll take testing. Either way, the highest tiers of shield are desirable due to their durability, and so we don't lose our motivation to mine. Secondly, remember that food is a staple of our current combat system. Healing is vital because damage is pretty much guaranteed. We're not gonna let it become obsolete. Horses have a stamina bar, now dashes do too. Food grants significantly quicker stamina recharge on top of hunger. That should stop dashing from being overpowered, and after reducing the healing effect of a full hunger bar somewhat, it'll balance food too. With combat sorted, I think it's worth revisiting a Reddit post from 7 years ago, because if we're looking to improve exploration, the insights it delivers are relevant even today. Minecraft suffers from a case of split personality. The adventure half and the construction half. These two halves aren't integrated well, and as a result, Minecraft doesn't live up to its potential as an adventure game. The first 3 days of a survival world are entirely different from everything else that follows. In those first days, everything is a threat, and you're on a very tight schedule, scrambling to collect resources before nightfall. It's great, hectic fun. After you build a base and reach the iron tier, you'll feel pretty secure for the rest of the game. That's when the adventure half largely disappears. Why? If you want to make anything of note, you need to mine in bulk. If you want to climb the tech tree, you need lots of diamonds. If you want lots of enchantments, you need to fight lots of monsters. Theoretically, this is a good thing, because it should force you to leave your safe haven to adventure. However, the grind-like nature of the game contradicts that goal, because the most effective way to acquire things in bulk is to play conservatively. Why adventure in caves when you could get diamonds faster and more safely by mining down to 12 and strip? Mining. Why pick a fight with blazes when you can funnel them into a death trap? Why hunt monsters for XP when you won't get enough without building a farm? At this point, survival is a misnomer. The game has become about taming the world and advancing slowly but surely. Fun, but maybe not for everybody. That's where it ends. There's plenty of things I disagree with here, mainly the idea that the first few nights are a desperate scramble. Not with beds, they're not. The first night's been DOA since Beta 1.3. Secondly, the use of the word conservatively. It still takes effort to make a monster spawner, but it is exploitative, which is the word I'd use. Instead of interacting with the world in the quote-unquote intended way, you're exploiting the rules for the most efficient gain. Legitimate, of course, but perhaps not amazing game design. The point of that post was displaying how Minecraft's imbalances affect the need for adventure. But adventure is not all that suffers. I would add, why raid an ocean monument when the risk and resources are better spent on end cities every time? And why mine iron when you've gained enough diamonds? The miner systems influence play in major ways. So we fix the spawner system by throttling XP from mob spawner enemies, and balance by increasing XP gain from everything else. Fix a reliance on strip mining with things worth getting and seeing exclusive to caves. Fix the uselessness of late game iron by replacing the anvil's experience cost with an iron cost. Fix ocean monuments by upping the rewards. I mean, seriously, sponge and 8 gold blocks for all that? No sir. Same deal for woodland mansions, which are by a country mile the most challenging area in the game. Why on earth was it decided that the reward for beating the hardest challenge should be an item to save you from death? That's like training up to fight Arnold Schwarzenegger all for a protein shake and a 2-pound dumbbell. End cities feel rewarding for what they are, but the fact that they're easier to loot than a glorified leper colony undermines the atmosphere of the end. Most players fight the dragon before looking for a mansion. So, after having saved the world from an extra-dimensional deity, now prepare to fight some men in a house. Come on. For the most part, we can keep the rewards the same, just rebalance the difficulties. The Reddit post goes on to iterate a very interesting insight into one of Minecraft's greatest imbalances. All the places you need to explore are monotone, whereas all the places that are interesting to explore are inconsequential to gameplay. Think of it this way. On your average playthrough, you're going to need to hit a nether fortress and a stronghold, but these are extremely similar experiences every time. What you don't need to explore, apart from passing through to get to the stronghold, are the biomes. This is where Minecraft's random generation shines, the terrain. But it's all just set dressing. You can look at this imbalance two ways. A, Minecraft is making you explore the wrong areas. And B, Minecraft is failing to make its dungeon crawling interesting. Is it too much to ask for both? Exploration is a lot like building. It's something humans don't need explained to us. You'd have to actually be trying to make it inaccessible.
Cubalt.
So let's just think about the function. The focus on dungeons isn't necessarily the problem, because jungle and desert temples prove that they can encourage exploration of specific biomes. Well, desert temples do. They're even a bit too lucrative given how easy they are. Jungle temples, on the other hand, certainly not worth heading into a jungle to look for. Fixing that's just a small balancing act. Fixing other structures is a lot more difficult. End cities are good, they present a very unique challenge. Woodland mansions, strongholds, and nether fortresses, on the other hand, are just corridors, stairs, and rooms with some enemies littered about. I don't think redesigning these from the ground up is the answer, because I can't think of ways to do that without fundamentally changing what they are. Revised combat would revive the experience, but for the most part, I think we'll need to take the Mojang approach. Surface level improvements that make them less boring. Those strongholds have a potential for much more interesting dangers. Traps, spikes, pits, things like that. Generally, structures ought to improve through their core design. An interesting central mechanic. The biggest issue with this is that we're playing Minecraft, and being able to literally break the world, you might say, complicates things. But it's not an impossible situation. Woodland mansions disincentivize burning it down by having the rewards burn with it. End cities by making it too great a risk to take any route but the intended one. We don't need to restrict the player as much as ocean monuments, just make it so they have to play by the rules to get to the loot. I previously suggested a maze that you could mine through, but more silverfish pop out every time you do. By the 20th block, it's suicide to mine any further. So the central idea of the dungeon is that you have to be conservative with mining. You could have a desert dungeon where mining causes sand collapse. A volcanic dungeon that has you doing parkour to escape raising lava. Walls are made from obsidian, so you can't mine your way out in time. With a wider variety of structures, we can enrich both underground and overworld exploration. All it takes now is a bit of biome exclusivity, and Bob is your uncle. Or is he? Not yet, he's not. Minecraft lacks rewards. There'll come a point that more diamonds are simply useless. Let's be honest, redstone and gold aren't even worth mining for most players. Name tags? You'll run out of pets to name. Saddles? You'll amass enough horses. Though I think more interesting enchantments would be fantastic additions to the game, especially on armor, because they'd be useful even when you weren't taking damage, enchanting books will also get stale if there's nothing else worth getting. What I have in mind is inspired by both Dark Souls and Minecraft. You see, in Dark Souls, your path is not set. From the moment you're dropped into Firelink, there's several paths you can take, but due to the interconnected world design, that figure soon increases dramatically. After a few runs, you might think, I want this item, so I should go that way, which leads into here, and then there. Then loop around, grab this ring, pull that lever for later, and I'll be set in only an hour. Dark Souls makes exploration a deeply interesting decision-making process. Minecraft can't mimic handcrafted level design, but it can take inspiration. I want more loot in the form of items that fundamentally alter play. By tying those rewards to biomes, we gain that interesting decision-making process on spawn. For this playthrough, I have this goal, therefore I'm going to look for this biome to grab this item. On the way, you'd pick and choose your route by biomes which have the most relevant loot, but it's better still, because we've done fix the first night. No point in the classic 2x1 hole with a door on the front if you're not planning to stay 100 meters away from spawn the whole time. Even if you do, at least you've made a decision. Otherwise, you're going to be on the move with a goal in mind, making interesting choices for several nights at least. Let's look at an example. This is where the inspiration from Minecraft comes in. The conduit. With a heart of the sea, which you get from buried treasure chests, and nautilus shells, which you get from drowned fishing and trading, you get the conduit. When placed, it allows you to breathe underwater, mine comfortably underwater, and protects you from waterborne enemy mobs, all in a specific radius. It's brilliant! It fundamentally changes aquatic play, and logically, you get it from aquatic activity. It forces you to build, it looks sweet, it's everything we need. Apply it to the polar biomes, for example. Here we can get an item that in a specific radius, I don't know, stops fire spread, makes it snow, turns water to ice, magnetizes all pickups towards itself, turns you invisible to hostile mobs, can summon a stone sword every 5 minutes, turn mobs against each other, gives you a window into any other location on the map, sends a signal when a hostile mob is nearby. Any combination of all of those. There's plenty of potential. The effect simply needs to be balanced with the effort it takes. Some of these need to be placed or built up to work, some of them need to be equipped in a slot. Some appeal to intrinsically motivated players, some extrinsic, some both. Either way, if we want it, we have to interact with the biome's features. Polar bears drop one part, another can be found in the secret room of an igloo, and the last hidden under the ice sheets. No one's sleeping on biomes now. Link exploration into building with biome-specific fruit trees and crops, which grants additional visual variation and extra motivation to explore and build. Then link it into mining. Biome-specific caves has been done with mods, but we can do better than icy caves and sandy caves. Provide unique gameplay with iced-over subterranean lakes. They crack and mobs burst out from underneath. Sand can cause collapses after a period of rumbling to warn. I also like the idea of biome-specific gemstones. You'd want them because they're pretty, and because in place of lapis, they could influence the enchantments you're likely to get. Amethyst makes sharpness more likely, for example. These would present in the form of crystals instead of ore, because crystals can only be found in caves, thus incentivizing cave diving over strip mining, which helps iron out that imbalance. I would say that Bob is now indeed our uncle. But what if we want Fanny to be our aunt? Well, in that case, I think we should look at putting a thrill into exploration. Danger is a core aspect of practically every good adventure in life or in media. Minecraft is lacking, so we fix it with biomes. I want a volcano biome. I want a polar biome so polar that it's in a permanent blizzard. I want quicksand. I want ice sheets to crack. I want predatory animals, poison fruit, poison trees, winds that make it harder to move in a specific direction at the peaks of the highest mountains. Let me roleplay Ernest Shackleton. That's exploration covered, but there's one last thing to address. It's a big one. God damn it, we need a new dimension. It doesn't have to be as in-depth as the Aether, it just needs to be an answer to one of Minecraft's worst extrinsic flaws. What do after the end? The hardest part of the Ender Dragon fight is getting there, but after that, you can get more powerful, but to what end? A new dimension is without question the smartest way of providing an endgame experience without poorly ripping off Terraria. No one is asking for bosses after the Moon Lord, so don't assume we'll be stuck in a cycle of people beating the hardest challenge and then asking for something harder. Everyone is different, but for those reasonably experienced with games, the Ender Dragon simply isn't a satisfying challenge, and it never really has been. It's not tough enough to warrant grinding gear. All you really need is a stack of ladders and a decent aim. And hey, this finally gives Mojang an opportunity to follow through on the Sky Dimension. I think that's a good place to end it, my realistic improvement for Minecraft. Well, it's bittersweet. It's a good place to end my ideas for the mode we have today. But survival being DOA is more of a tragedy than you might think. I fundamentally disagree with the idea that survival creates an inherently anti-creative environment, and should never have been a part of Minecraft. In my opinion, humans are at their most creative when there is a problem to solve. Combat in Minecraft has always been a bit of a disappointment. It's a game built on the sandbox idea, but practically every point of progression is locked behind a bog-standard shallow combat system. Personally, I think combat in Minecraft would have been better if it was designed to be performed through building. If your sword stroke was a trap and your arrow shot was a redstone-activated dispenser. That's how you put the creativity in the combat. And it's why today I'm even more confident with my hardcore survival idea. We remove beds, but forget thirst bars. Instead, every 24 days, winter comes, and with it, the winter army. An overwhelming, nigh unstoppable horde of mobs with smart AI and the ability to break blocks. They have one goal: kill you. No level of combat mastery can save you. The only way to survive is preparation, building. As the season cycle progresses, you might eventually have the metal to take the fight to the army. You kill the Night King, that's considered a win state. A very good parallel, in my opinion, to the conquest type mode we've been crafting for most of this video. I'd like to leave it on this. This is my perfect update to Minecraft. But what's the point in telling you? What's the point in making my ideas accessible? What's the point in making sure I don't suggest anything too taxing on the computer? Well, you'd think it's because it's something Mojang could do, but would they? They've shown no interest in overhauling anything. What incentive do they have? There's no money in it. So why go to the effort? Why go to the risk of making something that people don't like? Expecting Mojang to overhaul the game is inherently unrealistic. Are mods the true answer? Perhaps. But as I said in the last video, they rarely stick to vanilla's charm. And mods aren't all developed with a singular vision in mind. They're certainly not packed together that way. It makes gems like RLCraft a rare sight. A villager mod, for example, might have one system that fits my vision and 10 systems that don't. Same thing for anyone's vision. It's not like they're shipped system by system. And then of course you have to consider that most mods are restricted to Java PC, which leaves behind vast swathes of the community. But despite all that, is there really any other way? Perhaps then, it's better for Mojang to focus their efforts on improving Minecraft as a platform for what it can be. Back-end improvements, optimization, a modding API. Perhaps the true perfect update is giving my perfect update and everybody else's a better chance to exist. Perhaps the truest potential Mojang can realize is making Minecraft a truer engine for potentials to be realized, as it has been in so many ways to so many people. Thank you all for watching. This was the final installment in my Minecraft critique trilogy. God knows I didn't expect to be saying that this year. I hope you've enjoyed it. If this is the first of the three you've watched, the order doesn't matter, but there's a hell of a lot more to go back and see. I'd like to restructure all three into a director's cut type thing next year. But until then, I have a huge backlog of videos on games of all sorts, and there's plenty more to come. If you'd like to help support this content, I do have a Patreon, and every new subscriber counts. Special thanks go out to my $5 plus patrons. Lex Williams, Just Anima, Ludwig Salen, Leon Katendahl, Holy Shift, Chance Tucker, Douglas Griffith, Combat Wombat, Sim, Noah B. Satterley, Thomas Landell, Juris Purins, Abby, L. Hudson, Rosa, Benjamin Carter, Bishop Nelson, John Lemley, Fabian Flack, Zachary Scott, Shade, Quarter Gamer, Captain Excellent, Noah Thorsager, Snazzy Mazzy, Maddie, Sleepy Bear, Quincy P., Trixie Lalamoon, and Dominic Jaworski. I hope to see you next time. Goodbye.